Can an MRI show where the pain is coming from? Look at this MRIs. Here, there is a disc protrusion. This other one has a disc bulge. Interestingly, these two people never had back pain. So, today I'll talk about magnetic resonance imaging in back pain. MRI stands for magnetic resonance imaging. I remember the introduction of MRI in medicine. I was in residency, and this was more than 30 years ago. And for the first time, we saw images of the soft tissues, the muscles, ligaments, and tendons with such details. We were all so excited. We thought we would resolve everyone's pain problems. We could pinpoint precisely where the problem is and eliminate it and fix the pain. We started ordering more and more MRIs. The technology also advanced, and the images became better and had higher resolution, so we could see even more details. So this has been more than 35 years ago that MRI was invented. And we did solve some problems, but did we solve the problem of pain, especially musculoskeletal pain? No, actually the issue of pain is even more severe now than it was 35 years ago. Back pain is the number one cause of disability by a non-communicable disease worldwide. The costs of treating chronic pain are more than the costs of treating cancer, cardiovascular diseases, and diabetes combined. All these three combined. So what is wrong? MRI was supposed to tell us what was wrong and guide us in fixing it. However, MRI is so sensitive and shows irrelevant changes that it leads to false positive diagnosis. But once an abnormality is seen in an MRI, the patient gets worried and the doctor feels an obligation to treat that abnormality. Many people have not only one, but many MRIs of the same spot to try to identify the cause of their pains. Neck, lower back, hips, knees, ankles, shoulders, elbows, hands, etc. Of course, in many instances, the MRI is beneficial. But this is the minority of cases with chronic pain. And even less when the person has chronic pain for a lot of years. Let me illustrate this with two cases. So I wrote about cases in my book, The 8 Steps to Conquer Chronic Pain. And here on page 51, I talk about two cases, Mark and Mike. I'm going to read for you. Mark is a 30-year-old man who has had cerebral palsy since birth. His hips, knees, feet have severe deformities. He has had multiple surgeries to correct the shortened tendons. The x-rays and MRIs of his joints show very severe osteoarthritis. His shoulders have multiple areas of compression of tendons and bone abnormalities because he uses a walker. Mike is a 26-year-old man who works 12 hours a day as an office assistant. His manager is very demanding, his co-workers are lazy. He's the only one in the office who knows how to do the job well. So his boss keeps giving him more and more work, while the other staff are always chatting in the kitchen about the latest TV shows. He doesn't have time to watch TV, as he's always exhausted. His x-rays and MRIs of the neck do not show any abnormality. Who has chronic pain? Mark or Mike? If you see Mark's x-rays and MRIs, you will think he is in constant, terrible, excruciating pain 24 hours a day. But it's quite the opposite. Mark does not have any pain. Mike has constant pain in his upper back and shoulders and chronic migraines. So why is that? There are many reasons why MRIs fail to help in the diagnosis of pain. In the case of Mark, the abnormalities of his MRI do not necessarily cause pain. In Mike's case, his back pain comes from muscle tension caused by stress at work. Even if his MRI is abnormal, it's not that abnormality that is the cause of his pain. MRI is a static picture. The person is not moving, and some types of pain are aggravated by specific compression of structures, and only when the body is in certain positions is the structure compressed. We have to remember that MRI shows that our body changes over time. Our skins get wrinkled and our bones get spurs, our intervertebral discs get dehydrated. But these are just expected changes. So when we see these things in an MRI, we get alarmed. But when we do MRIs of people who do not have any pain, we'll also see these changes. But their presence does not mean the person will have pain caused by that change. It was just a coincidence. But where is the pain coming from? If it is not from that abnormality seen on the MRI, well, it could be muscle tension, which isn't showing in an imaging study. It could be from a weak muscle, which isn't shown in any imaging. It could be nociplastic changes like central sensitization or pain amplification. None of this will show in a spine or any MRI. And here in my book, I also have this picture here that you can see in this slide. These were many studies were done that they did MRIs of healthy people. Yeah, you would imagine why they do that, because it's a study, it's for research. So the proportion of abnormal MRIs among people who are asymptomatic, they do not have any back symptoms, were alarming. And it increases with age. So there are older adults that don't have any pain, no back pain. And when they did MRIs of those older individuals, they found disc degeneration in 96%, disc bulge in 84%. And disc protrusion in 43%. And those abnormalities were also common in younger people with a less proportion. The best method to detect where the pain comes from is by talking to and examining the patient. Suppose there is a nerve compression, a fracture, a tumor, or an infection. In that case, the physician will raise suspicions and confirm them by ordering an imaging study, which could be an MRI. The problem these days is that physicians don't have time to talk to patients, and even less to examine the patients. And it is much easier to order an MRI. But this is not always the right thing to do. An MRI can cause damage to the patient. There are various research showing that in places where physicians order too many MRIs, the doctors will end up over-diagnosing things. They will explain that the back pain is due to a disc bulge, a disc herniation, cysts, facet joint problems, etc., when in fact, even people who don't have lumbar pain have all of these things. And these things rarely explain why the person has pain. But then, if the doctors overdiagnose them, they have more procedures, more injections, and surgeries. And think about this. All of these procedures have risks and side effects. Also, they cost a lot of money. And what are the worst adverse effects? Do you know what they are? If the person gets the wrong treatment, they don't have time to try the proper treatment. They will not get better if they don't receive the appropriate treatment. Their pain will recur. Back surgery is appropriate in a minority of cases of back pain. That is why getting a proper diagnosis, not just an MRI, is necessary. Thousands of people had 1, 2, 3, 4, even more lumbar surgeries to treat lower back pain. Clearly, surgery was not the right choice. I'm not saying that lumbar surgery and injections should be avoided entirely. No, there are situations in which they are indispensable. Now, if you are a healthcare professional, you may download my handout about differentiating neuropathic pain from nociplastic pain. If your patient has back pain from a nociplastic mechanism, then you should be able to treat them without an MRI or surgery. Go to the description of this video below and find the link to download this free handout. And please remember, this video is not medical advice. If you think you have a pain condition, please talk to your healthcare professional. And if there is an emergency, please go to the nearest emergency department or call an ambulance. This video is for educational purposes only. Send this video to anyone who needs to hear this today. There is a send button here. Bye!